Thanks for joining our web exclusive. I'm Mike Montecalvo, along with Eyewitness News analyst Lieutenant General Reginald Santracchio. The Obama administration is doing a, quote, lousy job when it comes to Afghanistan. We'll get to those comments in just a moment. But first, General, let's talk about Libya. And if you had to use one word to describe what's going on in that country, probably you could say the word is bailing, because people are just leaving.
They are, and I think they understand what the eventual consequences are going to be, because that's going to be undoubtedly, once again, in my opinion, you will see a civil war in Libya, because that's exactly what it's coming to. You have the rebels, who are representative of the majority of the people there, taking on the military, and somewhere along the line they're going to have to take sides. If you have part of your population supporting the military, another part supporting the rebels, you're going to see an obvious civil war. Plus, keeping in mind, many people are coming into that country, too.
Well, a UN official is saying Muammar Gaddafi's forces are targeting Egyptians and Tunisians, and that's why, number one, they're fleeing, and number two, there is unrest. But there's more to that.
Absolutely. You know, I think if you look at the reality of it, the people on the ground are representative of a mix from that entire area. And when you look at the true problem in Libya, it is because they don't want a dictatorship anymore. And they've tried to do this in a way that is going to be a requirement that they have to take a side. And that will undoubtedly result in a civil war, as we're seeing unfolding as we speak.
You know, we've heard some people say that this is not an oil issue, but one of the first targets for Gaddafi was along the coast, where there is an oil installation plant there. They did seize control, but now apparently rebel forces have taken over there. So he knew to key in on that one spot, because it would affect the entire world.
Well, he knows that it will affect mostly Europe. You know, we depend on some of that oil coming out of the Mideast area, and specifically Libya, but we don't depend on it as a lion's share of it. But Europe does, and I think he realizes that what happens in Europe has an effect on national security for the United States. So he knows that it's a real significant area that he needs to maintain under his control. He was unable to do that. But now the next is what happens to the rest of the oil in Libya, and what happens to the ability to get it out of that area, which has to go through the Suez Canal and the pipeline.
Well, he's failed there. Now, his forces have been driven out of that area. Matter of fact, they've been backed up into a local university. So that's a failure on his part. Do you see it crumbling, or is that just one isolated incident?
I think you'll see it crumbling, especially when you look at if the United Nations and specifically the U.S. look at a no-fly zone, that will certainly limit the scope of what his capabilities will be, and that's to bring in additional help through the military to deal with such things as attacking his own air bases. That's going to be a consideration if, in fact, does result in a no-fly area over Libya itself.
Well, General, you're talking about attacking his own air bases. If you hear about it, he's lashing out against the United States and Europe because they want him to step down. He said no, and then he has said that he will kill his own people first before he steps down. So what does that tell you about, you know, the leader of Libya?
He's crazy. I mean, it's pretty simple in my mind. He's a deranged individual. He also said that Libyans are willing to die for him. Perhaps those that have no other choice will, but I don't think they'll do it.
But is that a small amount now?
I think so. I think we're seeing that even his own military are starting to disintegrate and leaving the military itself, to include defectors of his air force, as well as some of the major leaders of the military itself. So I think what he's saying is really something in his own mind. The reality of it, he does not have the backing of the Libyan people.
All right. The United States has said they want him out. The president has said so. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton said they want him out. He's not leaving. So what's next for the United States?
The next thing would be to be in a position of to be able to defend whatever is of importance, our own national security and world security. Then I think you'll see us move from a humanitarian position to an actual insertion of military assets. That's already pre-positioned in the Mediterranean, to include a carrier as well as other air assets. Whether that happens or not, I think has a lot to do with our resolve to be able to go in and hopefully not start another scenario where we're already committed in Afghanistan, Iraq, and if we need more forces in Libya to maintain the security. I don't know that we have that capability without United Nations participation.
I was going to say the UN has to be in on this.
Absolutely,
this to be
and
successful.
It has to be take a bigger bite out of what we've seen in Afghanistan and in Iraq.
You know, most of the troops that go over there are United States troops. When do we get other countries to say, you know, we need to start splitting this up here?
I think when other countries realize that they are as subjected to the world economy as we are and the entire free world is, they'll start to understand they need to be part of the solution, not just stand by, allow the United States to go in, and then criticize it afterwards. It's very easy to stand by sides, by the sideline, saying that you should have done this, should have done that, with a little bit of participation. But I think if it goes beyond Libya, and we see it throughout the entire Mideast, other nations that are really dependent upon the oil coming out of that area, as we are, you'll see better participation because of necessity.
Not hearing much from Russia or China in all of this.
Right now, I think they just are comfortable standing by, watching the United States and other a few other countries trying to deal with this, hoping that they're not going to get caught in the middle and get into another quagmire.
Because Russia doesn't need the oil, they're not getting involved in this? You think that's one of the main reasons?
I think one of the main reasons is exactly that. Russia is the highest producing oil country in the world. They could be perhaps independent of depending upon other countries' oil, and I think maybe that's part of the problem as far as them participating in protecting the oil out of the Middle East. Maybe they're just waiting for a position to insert themselves, and all of a sudden they walk in at the at an appropriate time, and therefore similar to what we had in Berlin right after World War II. You know, everything was revolving around Berlin, and at the very last minute, Russia walks in to be able to say, okay, we want this, we want that, we want East Berlin, and we'll split it up the way we think it should happen. I'm not suggesting that's going to happen in the Mideast, but that's one of the philosophies that we need to be aware of, that Russia's in it for what Russia thinks is important to her, as we are for what's important to the United States.
Well, General, you're talking about humanitarian aid right now. There is the possibility that we would do military exercises there, but we're not talking about North Korea, South Korea. We haven't even talked about Iran yet and how we get all of those involved, because there are conflicts in each one of these parts of the country or parts of the world.
Yeah. The United States, I don't believe, has the resources nor the political will to be able to go in and police the entire world. We just don't have that capability. We have got to depend on the United Nations and to be able to have additional countries come in and police it along with us. In as much as we can certainly win, if we used all of our capability to go in and win a physical war, there's no doubt in mind we could do it. But what happens when you win? You own it. And I don't believe that we're going to get into another land war as we did in Iraq and certainly Afghanistan.
You know, with all this, we're hearing today, General, that Defense Secretary Robert Gates says the U.S. has done, this is a quote, lousy job listening to the complaints of Afghan's President Hamid Karzai and responding to his concerns. What do you make of all of that?
I make that he's right. You know, we did a miserable job as far as looking at what happens after you go in and win the military aspects of a ground war that we obviously have seen in Iraq as an example, and to some extent in Afghanistan. Unless you have a real good feeling for the culture of that particular country, all the military in the world isn't going to matter, because battles in the eventual country coming over to having a facsimile of democracy is based upon the culture of the country, and we've done a miserable job understanding that before we went into the country.
Well, Karzai is saying a lot of the private companies that are in his country are out of control, and that's one of the things they're having a problem with.
Yeah, exactly. You know, but if you look at Germany, you look at Japan, you look at any of the countries that are the residual effects of any war, you always have that as a particular phase of what happens afterwards. What they're going through is the exact the genesis of where democracy comes from eventually, because you have companies in there trying to take advantage of a very vulnerable area, about trying to get their foot in the door without regards to what is best for the country. And I think the observations are that it's only somewhat of a monetary reason that different people, and perhaps that is the case, and you have different scenarios only based upon what is good for the companies that are presently in that area.
Well, speaking about money, Democrats and Republicans are talking about cutting spending in Afghanistan. How does this all play in now with you're hearing what Karzai has to say, and now we're about to cut aid?
Yeah, I don't think we're going to do that. I don't think we'll cut aid, because if you cut aid, what you're doing is you're putting more military in to sustain the country. Right now, you're looking at some of that aid, hopefully, going into building the Afghan security forces, both military and civilian, and you're also maintaining the money that's going into Iraq to maintain the stability that we have to some extent there. So I think looking at cutting aid is not going to happen. That's a good maybe argument or debate point, but I don't think you'll see that at all. If that's the case, then we should start cutting aid to many other countries that perhaps are not using it as it's intended. That's to build up democracies.
Well, Congressman Cicilline is just back from his trip overseas. He did not bring any troops back with him. He talked about when he became elected that he was going to bring them home. I think the interesting thing was he never talked about that on his trip back.
Yeah, exactly. And that bothers me personally because I saw this exact scenario during the campaign that Senator Whitehouse used. His comment was he would have troops home before Christmas during that same election year. Yeah, that was just, you know, a word and something that went out there to hopefully win some votes for him. And it did for his election. And the same thing with Cicilline. I think what they do is they try to cater to people who don't want us to be there, suggesting that once they get into Congress, they're going to have some major impact on ending the war and bringing troops home. Well, that's nice to say, but the reality of it is that neither one of them can do it.
All right, before we run out of time, we want to talk about a big story that's been floating around is the fitness requirements for the Army and the National Guard. They're kind of changing things up whether you're going into combat or not.
Right? I think the basic, as I read it, and as I read it and as I understand it, the basic concept for physical fitness has been lessened to some extent. As an example, you know, a two-mile run is no longer 2 miles. It's a mile and a half. You get a minute for push-ups versus the 2 minutes that you used to have. But the most significant area is that they've looked at a combat readiness physical fitness thing, which I think is the right way to go. So when you know you're going to go into combat, part of the pre-mobilization is to make sure that troops can, in fact, meet that criterion set out for stress and other physical requirements are going to be required of them during combat.
Well, they have to run a quarter of a mile combat ready, which means full gear. What happens if they can't do that?
They're not deployed. You know, you could either be taken out individually or a particular platoon or a battery or a company or a division may not pass its ability to go into combat because of physical fitness inabilities. And I've seen that done with the old test too, because you do go through a process to give certification to that particular unit that's about to be deployed. They will not be deployed unless they can meet those physical requirements.
You know, General, they're also looking at what happens when troops go into areas where there's a lot of smoke and fire and how they can combat that. That's something they haven't really done 30, 40 years ago. They're really centering on this now.
They didn't, but once again, it's nothing new. Man, that was one of the major considerations during the Civil War. When you were on the opposite side of where the wind's coming from, and once those cannons started to go off and other muskets were firing, you had a tremendous amount of battlefield smoke and those kinds of things. Nothing new today, perhaps more generated than of the weapon systems themselves. But there are techniques and capabilities that are being devised for us to be able to see through that, not at the individual level, but our ability to see through the smoke and the other considerations to be able to see what's happening on the other side.
What happens if a soldier wants out and they just fail these new tests?
That's always a strong possibility. You know, they can't pass the test. They do it maybe intentionally. I'm not suggesting that is the case, but that's a possibility. Same thing with addiction to drugs as well as alcohol or some other considerations. There are always ways that soldiers are able to obtain a discharge, but I'm glad to say that is not the norm. And you have one or two here, but it's always been that way, and I don't think that'll change regardless of what the standards are.
Okay, and finally, a Rhode Island National Guard unit will be deployed next week.
43rd MP Brigade going out the door, ceremony Monday, under the command of Brigadier General Charlie Petracker. They'll be assuming the responsibility for the detention facilities in Afghanistan, with the end goal being that they turn those facilities over to the Afghan authorities as part of the withdrawal plan.
Okay. General Cintraki, as always, thank you for your comments.
Good to be here.
All right. Thanks for watching.